It could well trigger a new era for our national game. The Gaelic Players Association met formally for the first time in Belfast last night.
The players probably feel it's time that maybe some of their ideas were heard.
The breakaway Gaelic Players Association and the GAA hierarchy seem set on a collision course tonight.
The official recognition agreement between the GAA and GPA provides for joint commercial ventures.
The player development programme that's in place is something that's vital to the well-being of our players.
You do your utmost to serve the members, and that excites me a whole bunch.
Every day, you know, we're working with players. They're the centre of everything that we do.
You're very welcome along to The Player's Voice. I'm Kieran McSweeney. I'm joined, as always, by my co-host, Leash footballer, Colm Begley. Colm, how are you keeping?
Good, Kieran. Yourself, mate?
Very well now. And look, we're talking at a time where we see now GAA pitches around the country back open, club training back up and running, a real air of positivity there. And that's what we want to focus on The Player's Voice this week. We would usually talk to a player or players about different issues, different aspects of their lives. But what we've decided to do this week, and we're delighted that she was able to take the time, is talk to Professor Mary Horgan. Now, Mary Horgan is on the GEA's COVID Advisory Committee. She's the president of the Royal College of Physicians. She's a consultant physician in infectious diseases and internal medicine at Cork University Hospital, a real expert in infectious diseases. And we thought it was really a good opportunity when she was able to take the time to talk to us about this return to play. And we know that there are players, there are coaches, there are supporters, there are parents, there are family members who have concerns about the fact that the GAA season is back up and running. And I think it's important that we get as much information as we can, and I suppose educate ourselves and maybe help to get information out there that would make it, I suppose, as easy as possible for people to minimise any risks, but also to give them the information to make a decision where some may want to opt out.
Yeah, and look, that's the most important thing, Kieran. Like, as a player now who's going back myself, and as someone who's obviously been in the process of seeing this evolve, the RTP come back into kind of design and stuff like that, I still have concerns going back in. I think every player will. So for me, I think this is about getting as much information out to people about who's at risk. Players probably don't see themselves as being at risk as much. It's probably more concerned about the people they're close to, whether that be parents, partners, family members, etc. So for us to bring Mary on and get her to talk through the rationale behind RTP, why it's safe to do so, the risks that are there, the responsibilities of us that we can reduce that risk, that will then allow me as a player to go, okay, I can make a decision to stay and play or opt out for that season, which is totally fine as well. And I think we've seen over the last 4 to 5 weeks how it's kind of progressed so quickly. I'm definitely talking to players and going, how has it gone from this to this? So to hear her discuss that will definitely put me at ease, and I think a lot of other players too. So very excited to talk to her.
So we'll talk to Professor Mary Horgan in just a few moments.
The Gaelic Players Association. Representing the interests of all intercounty players, protecting their welfare on and off the pitch, and supporting their development as people.
Well, we're delighted to be joined now on The Player's Voice by Professor Mary Horgan. And Professor Horgan is the president of the Royal College of Physicians. She's a former dean of UCC School of Medicine, and she's also a consultant physician in infectious diseases and internal medicine at Cork University Hospital. Professor Horgan, thanks very much for joining us, first of all, on The Player's Voice.
Delighted to be joining you.
Professor Horgan, why we wanted to get you on, look, it's real signs of optimism and positivity around Gaelic games at the moment. We've seen this week pitches being reopened, club teams back training, and there really is this feeling that we've turned a corner. But at the same time, there are players both at club level and at intercounty level who will have concerns and do have concerns. And I suppose that's why we wanted to talk to you as an expert in infectious diseases, maybe to allay some of those fears, put people's minds at ease, but also at the same time to be realistic about the fact that there is still and remains a risk and how we can minimise that risk of contracting of COVID-19. But first of all, a little bit about yourself, Professor Horgan. You might talk to your background.
So I'm a Kerry woman, and I suppose I'm steeped in GAA. My father was very involved when he taught in St. Vincent's in Dublin before moving back to Kerry after he got married. And he was one of the founders of Bord na Nóg in Kerry. And I suppose my memory as a child was the phone calls just coming up to the third Sunday in September, swapping tickets from Hogan to Cusack and stand tickets and all of that. Big GAA fan. My brother Rossa Horgan is a GP in Westport and is very involved in training some of the underage teams there. So yeah, true and true GAA football. I love hurling, but obviously hurling in Kerry is really mainly an art fort, but not beyond that.
And how does one come to become an expert in infectious diseases?
Okay, so I trained in, went to UCD for my medical degree, spent a few years in Ireland doing my basic medical training, and then went off to the States. There was no specialty of infectious diseases here in 1990 when I went. So it was exactly this time 30 years ago, I flew to St. Louis. And spent 7 years training and being on the faculty of one of the major medical centers in the US. And at the time, there was a lot of, you know, AIDS, HIV was a major, major issue at the time. So it really was immersing myself into being mentored by another Irish guy over there, Bill Powderly. And really, like most things, you know, you learn on the job. You get good supervision and come out with a specialty of infectious diseases, which I suppose, to put in context, what do I do in a day-to-day job? It's really looking after people with fevers of unknown origin, people with bone infections, skin infections, a lot of the things that you'd see on a field of play, meningitis, malaria, HIV, hepatitis, and tropical diseases. That's where my skill set is.
And how did it come about that you became part of the GEA's COVID-19 advisory group, and your background obviously in GEA stands out there?
Yeah, so I'd worked with Dr. Aina Falvey, who you'll know is a Cork man, who is the medical director of World Rugby. And he contacted me in early April and he said, look, what are we going to do about COVID-19? And I said, look, let's have a plan. Let's develop a document. And Aina took the lead on that. And that was published. And Sean Moffat, then Sean contacted me. And of course, I was more than happy to volunteer and lend my expertise in infectious diseases. And that's where it started. And thanks to John Horan, he had set up the advisory committee on COVID-19. And again, I suppose that was early May, and I encouraged them also to have a plan because, it's still a time of uncertainty. But as I've said many times, we do need to live with COVID for the foreseeable future, because the only way of eradicating the disease is a vaccine. And while I know New Zealand have been very successful, New Zealand is 2,000 kilometres from its nearest landmass. Ireland is not like that. So I suppose going forward, we have to learn how to live with it and, I suppose, mitigate against risks. And we'll talk about those, with the upcoming questions that you're going to have for me. So that's how I got involved. And I suppose on reflection, the GAA really have been to the forefront of all the sporting organisations within Ireland of getting a plan together in a safe way. So safe for players, safe for support staff, and safe for spectators.
And look, before we get on to, and we have some what I would call maybe basics around COVID-19 and the coronavirus, but before we get on to that, just one final question in terms of, and you mentioned being in contact with the guys in World Rugby. What has the approach been like, say in comparison, Gaelic games, obviously an amateur sport, versus the professional game, which World Rugby is involved in?
Yeah, I suppose there, you know, there are similarities, but there are also differences. The ability to have a, the professionals, I suppose they've more money to do other things. But saying that, I think that the amount of resource and work put into particularly education and the e-modules that the GA have done have been really outstanding. The other big difference is that because GAA sports, you're amateurs and people go to work and so have different exposures, whereas the professional rugby players tend to be, I suppose, socialise in smaller pods in many respects. So they both bring, I suppose, challenges, but also opportunities. Certainly I, I obviously go to games and all of that, but I hadn't realised how big a machine the GA is and how they were able to just come together and deliver what really has been an outstanding learning for all of the community in such a quick period of time.
And look, we'll come on now to something that I really only thought about this yesterday when we were preparing to speak to you, Mary. We've been speaking about the coronavirus COVID-19 in an Irish context, I suppose, realistically since February, March time. But we've heard about it in the news, some headlines coming from China back as far as maybe November, December. But I was asked yesterday, could I explain the coronavirus or COVID-19 in two or three sentences? And I was absolutely flummoxed. What is it?
Okay, so coronavirus, there's loads of them out there and a lot of them cause the common cold. We've seen, I suppose, two other coronavirus infections, MERS and SARS. People will remember SARS from about 2003. And this is SARS-2, essentially. So it's a type of virus, kind of in the same group. They're RNA viruses. And so the coronavirus, the name of it is SARS-CoV-2, and the disease it causes is COVID-19. And why it's called COVID-19 was that it was in 2019 when it was first discovered. And that was, the first reports were in late December, and the virus itself was identified about 10 days later, which was really, really quick, as this SARS-CoV-2.
And Mary, where did it come from, and how does it come up? How does a virus like this actually come about?
Yeah, so a lot of the new viruses that we see, I mean, we've seen swine flu, even HIV, it goes from one species to another. And in this instance, likely the bats cross species into humans. And while bats may be able to live with it, when it crosses a species like into humans, humans have never seen this particular virus, so there's no immunity, and then it causes sickness. So it's really trans species. The virus jumps from one species to another, and that's what causes the problem.
And look, finally, on this line of questions, is we've seen an awful lot said about the different symptoms, but I don't think it's any harm to again emphasize what they are, because I think we need to continue to obviously to watch out for those. How is it transmitted, and what are the key symptoms to be watched for?
Oh, okay. It's transmitted by either touch or by droplet transmission. So coughing, speaking really loudly, touching surfaces that may be infected. And when it's transmitted to somebody, the vast majority of people have very mild symptoms. And I think that's really important to remember, particularly in the younger age group. And they're also less likely to have any bad outcomes. So 80% of people who get it will have very mild symptoms. And then about of the remaining 20%, they may need more oxygen support. They may need to go into hospital. And a minority of people die. Of those that unfortunately passed on, 93% of them are over the age of 65. And the vast majority of those have some other underlying illnesses like blood pressure, heart disease, diabetes, obesity or chronic respiratory infections. So it's kind of unusual because in the beginning, like, you know, 3-4 months ago, we didn't know a lot of this. We now know a lot more than we did. And what's a bit unusual is that normally children get infected by respiratory infections like influenza. And so you see the impact of influenza in the very young and the very old. Interestingly, coronavirus or the SARS-CoV-2 seems to have little impact in children, both infecting them or they infecting others. So what we know now compared to 100 days ago is huge. And I keep on saying that there's, as you said in the beginning, there is no such thing as zero risk in anything we do. But we know that there is lower risk, and you can lower the lower risk are by age, and people who are otherwise healthy have a low risk of getting or having, you know, needing to go into hospital or anything like that. It's not zero, but it's low.
And Mary, just quickly on that again, then the symptoms you mentioned before.
Oh, yeah.
Could you just talk about how long it might take as well for these symptoms to show up? Because I think that's one of the big things between people wondering, like, they could be going around with it.
Yeah. So just to the major symptoms that people experience are a fever, a cough, shortness of breath, and interestingly, a loss of sense of taste and smell. Very occasionally you can get some diarrhea, but they are the major symptoms that we see. And usually the incubation period is a few days. That's the time from exposure to actually getting symptoms. It's probably about 5 to 7 days. And people tend to be infectious when they have symptoms. So when you have a cough or a fever, that's when you're most infectious to others. And that's why it's really important, that self-responsibility to yourself to get care and get tested, but also your behavior impacts your teammates in this instance and your GAA community. So that's why, look, if you have a fever and cough, it's not like the old days where you could go off and tip away on the field of play. And we've all done it. We've all gone to work with those. Not anymore, because of the potential that it could be COVID and you can transmit it to others.
Yeah.
And as you said, Mary, just to focus it in now on the return of Gaelic games. Look, and as I said at the top of this, we're all delighted to see pitches open and people back out playing our games. And I suppose what we want to do now is delve into that. And I suppose in particular, I suppose even 4, 6, 8 weeks ago, it looked like we mightn't see contact sport and including hurling, football, rounders, handball, that we wouldn't see these sports return in 2020. What has changed so much over the course of the last month to 6 weeks?
I suppose the key change is the dramatic reduction in the number of cases in the country. You know, they really peaked around, you know, mid to late April. And since that time, the number of cases has dramatically decreased. And why is this? Really because of the what they call non-pharmaceutical interventions. In other words, the things we did as people, you know, the washing of the hands, the social distancing, the cough etiquette, and more recently, the face mask in closed, crowded conditions. And in addition to that, the amount of testing and tracing and isolating of those who are positive. So it's a combination of things, and you'll hear people talk either about face masks or the 1 versus 2 meters. It's not any individual thing. It's the summation of what we do individually or and as a population and community combined with what the health services does, which is test and trace.
Right. So let's get into there are particular concerns that maybe players, coaches, supporters, parents will have. So let's run through some of those, because I think that would be hugely important. So clubs are back this week. And to be fair, and I think you said it, a huge achievement to all the Gaelic Games family for managing to get this far and to have be in a position in which pitches can reopen this week. What do you see now as being the most important, I suppose, responsibilities that people need to take, either themselves or as as a group to ensure that the risk is minimized?
I suppose what I would say is that that self-responsibility has a huge impact on the ability of the games to continue. So it needs to be taken seriously, I think, first and foremost. I know, you know, the paperwork, you know, may seem onerous, and somebody mentioned, God, that's a lot to do, but people need to understand it. It is serious. And if we want to, you know, stay out of where, you know, stay where we're at now, it's about understanding, you know, what the symptoms are, what you can do to prevent it being spread, what you can do to protect yourself. And when you do that individually, it has a knock-on effect, a positive knock-on effect to all your teammates and your spectators. I'm sure there'd be parents listening who may be saying, God, you know, my child mightn't understand a lot of that, but that e-learning that was done is really good if you understand that. And I think listening to the public health messages and to be sure that the GAA advisory committee have put in as many checks and balances in place that we can return to work, return to play safely. So, you know, again, and, you know, I know it sounds like saying the same old thing, but that hand hygiene, the cough etiquette, do not come to play if you've got any of the symptoms I spoke about, particularly fever and cough. Stay at home, phone your doctor, get tested. And for children and even for adults, the importance of sports for mental and physical well-being cannot be overstated. This, you know, is while, you know, this infection has changed the way we live, we can't let it control us either. And that's why I think it's really important to get back. And we all know that, you know, we just need to try to resume normal activity, of which sports is a big component.
Mary, you mentioned there, and I would totally agree with regards to sport being a hugely beneficial thing for people's well-being and so on and so forth. And as a player myself now, I'm back training and it's fantastic buzz to be around the guys. But as also someone who would have been quite strict and stringent to the restrictions and the etiquette and stuff during the last few weeks, it feels like we're going from 0 to 100 from my point of view with regards back to training and contact so soon. But can you just give me a bit of rationale behind why that? You've mentioned already about the cases being so low, but also playing outdoors, there's a lower risk of that, isn't there?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there are a number of studies now, but playing outdoors versus indoors, or activities outdoors versus indoors, there's probably about a 20-fold lower risk of getting COVID, which is huge when you think about it. You know, the fresh air, you're out there, you know, the wind is blowing. So your chances of picking up the infection outside is much lower than in a closed environment. And I think that's an important thing to emphasize to all of the players.
And further on from that then, Mary, as well, obviously we had the social distancing that's in place for the last number of weeks and months. And now we're looking at probably going from the 2 meters to the one. But for us players, going to close contact in multiple occasions, can you give a bit of logic behind that as well about why the risk isn't as high?
Yeah. So, you know, as I said earlier, the social distancing, the 2 versus 1, that's, you know, in the context of all of the other things we do. You know, quite honestly, it's really hard to live with 2 meter in anything we do, learning, sports, working. And I've no doubt it'll be brought down. And the science behind that is pretty inaccurate. I suppose it's older science. And where the biggest risk is, as I've said before, is people coming with any symptoms at all. And while some people may have, you know, no symptoms at all, it's not, they're probably less likely to transmit the virus. It's those with the fever and cough. But, you know, you can play a sport with, you know, 2 meters apart or even 1 meter apart. But most of the time, and I suppose I'm not an expert at it, I'm just a spectator. But, you know, people, you might, shoulder each other and all of that, but then you're going apart again. And even when they looked at a lot of the rugby, which you would think is high contact sports, their social distance was, they were only together in very close contact for less than 15 minutes. So look, it's a combination of, you know, don't come when you have symptoms. You know, you're playing in the outdoors, which is lower risk. You're moving around the field very quickly. You're a younger age group. You're fitter. And most people don't have the risk factors that really result in worse outcomes for some of the people who unfortunately either were hospitalized or passed on.
Actually, I've made quite a good career out of playing 2 meters apart from my man for the last number of years, Mary. So I'm actually feeling the same.
Yeah, my mother's from Rathdowney, so she lives in hope that Leash will prevail someday.
Hopefully.
Mary, on that point you made there about the fact that, look, the playing group is in that younger age group, but we did research amongst our members, and the WGPA did research amongst their own members as well. So what came back to us was that 17% of GPA members would have to consider whether they would opt to play in 2020, given their concerns. That number was higher among the WGPA players at 32%. But one of the interesting pieces that came back in our survey as well was that 56% of intercounty players are living with or are in close contact with a person who is considered to be in an at-risk group. So could you talk to us, first of all, maybe to define what an at-risk group is, and then what steps that players could take to minimise the risk that they could possibly pass this on to those people in that group?
Sure. And I suppose I'll put this in the context that that's the same question I get asked with people going back to work. So a lot of your players will be in a workplace too. So the same applies there. So the at-risk group, the older age group, you know, over 65, but most of those who ran into trouble had other illnesses, what we call comorbidities, and they were heart disease, high blood pressure, diabetes, high BMI, which is if they were obese, and chronic lung conditions. So there'd be the at-risk group. Below, I mean, if you look at under 50s who are healthy, otherwise healthy, their risk of having a bad outcome is very, very low. So what can people do to, I suppose, protect those that they may be living with? And again, this is the same as, you know, if their teacher's gone into school, or if they're, like, a number of your players would be healthcare workers, some work in that health environment. And the same happens there. It's about, you know, going home, washing your hands, having your shower when you come back in, not using the facilities that, from the outset, and ensuring that if you have any symptoms at all, you call your doctor and you get tested. That's how you protect them. But it's you know, the same absolutely applies when you're going back to work. So it's not just even specific to sport. And I can understand where the concerns may come from some of the players returning to work, because I suppose the message to date had been one of, I suppose, fear and concern, because we, as medical professionals, weren't absolutely sure who was risk. Were we all in the same boat in the beginning? We now know a lot more 100 days later than we did in March when the lockdown came in Ireland.
And something that has been raised by players as well, Mary, is the fact that, look, you look, say, for example, to the Premier League, and look, I can't stop smiling since last night with Liverpool clinching the Premier League title, their first title in 30 years. But you look to the Premier League, which is back up and running, but the rigorous testing that the players are undergoing. You look to, say, for instance, Australian rules football, which obviously GAA has links to over the years, where, again, players going through rigorous testing. You look to, say, golf in the United States, where the PGA Tour is up and running. But so rigorous testing as part of the approach. Why, and explain to us why it's okay for us to, and our players to return without undergoing testing?
Yeah, you know, I mean, when it comes to testing is really good with coronavirus if you have symptoms. OK, so that's the place of it. And this is this PCR testing, the nasal swab. if you're using it as a screening test, and people will know screening from cervical screening and bowel screening and all of that, your chances of getting a positive test in the absence of symptoms is very, very low. So, and it's only one point in time. So I could be exposed, you know, today, someone could swab me, I could be negative. 7 days time, I'd need to be swabbed again, and I may or may not be positive at that time. So it's not the test, and the PCR testing is not a screening tool. It's to diagnose the infection and to test those people who've been in contact with people who are positive. So the testing that was done recently in Australia, and that Tyrone man, there was some question, was that even a false positive? And you know the disruption that that can cause and did cause in it, in the Australian rules football. So there was, you know, everything got stopped. And did it need to stop? Maybe not, if it was a false positive. So that's the PCR testing, the one that you hear about all the time. And then the other one is the antibody test. So the PCR testing is a swab. The antibody testing is taking a pinprick and looking to see if you have antibodies as evidence that you've had infection in the past. The big challenge there is that we don't know for certain if you have antibodies, how long they last, and will they really protect you. They probably will, but I don't see any benefit at this point in time of routinely screening as they've done in golf, in rugby. I don't think it's cost effective, and it may not be, you know, may not give you the right answer. However, if, you know, if somebody in a team had a cough, a fever, of course they should get tested and get followed up. And that's the position, or the place of testing at this point in time in Ireland.
Just one more from me before I let Colm come back in, is on golf, because it's something, the conversations that I've been involved in, a couple of conversations this week. Golf, outdoors, absolutely minimal contact in comparison to our sports, but you see both players and caddies getting infected on the US tour and now having to withdraw from tournaments, and it's causing concerns there. Can you talk to us about that?
Yeah, well, I suppose if you're looking at the States, the infection is not under control there. I mean, it's not even a second surge. It just never got controlled over there. So they're living in an environment that we lived in back in March, where there was, you know, high levels of infection initially in the community and then with outbreaks. So we're looking at two very different countries. I mean, we have our infection under control. And of course, there may be a second wave. But if that is the case, I believe that with what we have all learned to do in protecting ourselves, but also the ability of our testing and tracing system to upscale again is really key. So comparing us at the moment as a country in the whole of Ireland, the all island, we're in a much better place than they are in the States, where they still don't have their infection controlled in many states.
Sure. Mary, you mentioned it's something that's kind of come a bit more out in the last few weeks. I think the contact tracing before was probably something we would have seen as what the medical professionals would do from their end, but I think there is a little bit more of onus now being put on the people to start recording their own contacts with people. I think there's an app coming out soon as well. How important is that going forward, that people in society, players, start to make sure they're recording the contacts they have? Obviously, if someone gets sick, then to have that information there available would be very, very useful.
Yeah, I think it's really important. I mean, we all meet a lot of people, but I think people are more conscious of not having too many contacts. Yeah. The key to controlling the infection, and really, you know, what we're essentially doing is protecting the hospitals from being overwhelmed. And thankfully, that never happened in this country, is to, if you become symptomatic, that you're well able to say, look, these are the 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 people that I interacted with. And, you know, the interaction is, you know, it's more than 15 minutes at close contact. Just give it, I mean, the whole idea of testing and tracing is not punitive in any way. It's to protect the individual. so that we can look after them and make sure that they stay healthy, or if they need care, that we provide that, but also to protect their family and the community in which they work. And that in this instance includes players. So it is important. And most people would have a fair idea of who they've had contact with in the past few days and the period. And the contact tracers are really experienced at getting that information.
Just another one that springs to mind and has come up, and you mentioned earlier, Mary, the fact about the virus and how you can how the virus transmits, and the fact that it can come off surfaces. How long does it live on a surface? And I'm thinking particularly from the point of view of catching a football, catching a slitter, catching a hurley, bibs, cones, all of those kind of things on pitches. Any concerns around those?
Not really. You know, the risk with those is low. And I spoke with my colleague, Professor Martin Cormican. You probably have heard his name. He's a clinical microbiologist and infection prevention and control specialist. And he said, look, at the end of the game, you just wash down the equipment and let it dry. And it's unlikely that we'll stay on those surfaces for any period of time. So it's doing what we probably should have been doing all the time, cleaning equipment. And, you know, reducing the spread of any infection, and that includes influenza. We've seen mumps. All of those have decreased given all of the things that we've been doing up to now. There was an outbreak of mumps, within the younger age group in universities and all that. Once social distancing was brought in, that all stopped. So I think it's being practical about what you can do, but like look after the equipment like we should be doing. So that risk is going to be low.
And just before we move on to maybe some other things as well, we've mentioned already, and a part of the return to play has mentioned cool camps, and I'm sure a lot of parents are very excited, but some also may be very nervous about returning to these. But you've mentioned some of the information already, Mary, about younger kids obviously not being as affected as badly from the virus. But I've coached in cool camps for a while, numbers in tight spaces, and a lot of younger kids who may not understand or appreciate the social distancing as much. But can you just go over again why it's safer to return to that at the moment, and why parents can be reassured that it's okay to allow their kids to join in these camps?
Well, I suppose first and foremost, as I said before, physical activity in children is so important to ingrain it at an early stage. But a lot of information is coming through, like from the science community, on the impact of COVID-19 on children and adolescents. And numerous studies now show that their risk of either getting the infection, or even if on the occasion that they do get it, they do not seem to have any bad impact. And when I was even talking to my pediatric infectious disease colleagues, they just don't see it. They don't see it coming to hospital. There is a syndrome that you can, but it's really, really uncommon, and it is absolutely treatable. You can't keep social distancing kids. It's just not. And the only instance I would say, because they're going to run around together, but the impact impact of COVID on that group is so, so low. So they're in a very low risk group for bad effect from COVID-19. And I certainly, based on the knowledge that we have at this point in time, think that the benefits of going back to sports for children without social distancing far outweigh the risks. And all my colleagues in paediatrics within the College of Physicians would absolutely support that.
I suppose it's up to a large role is placed on parents just to ensure that kids are sticking to the, the hygiene guidelines, washing of hands, the coughing, those kind of areas first. To do that.
And to be honest, I think kids have been particularly good at doing the hand washing and the cough etiquette, and I think pointing out to parents what they should be doing. So reiterating simple messages.
Yeah.
That's it. Wash your hands. If you're sick, do not come to training.
Yeah. Mary, you've been really good with your time, and just wanted to a final couple of questions before we finish up. We have I say club games and club training and pitches open at the moment. Come September, October, we're looking at inter-county season starting back up. Look, it's not going to be the same. We're not going to have 40, 50, 60,000 people at games in stadiums. But what's realistic? Or is it too early to tell? Because we've seen how things have changed so quickly over the course of the last 4 or 6 weeks that projecting that far ahead mightn't even have any benefit.
I would absolutely agree with that. I think we're still in uncertain times when we come into the autumn. You know, we see more viruses like, you know, influenza and RSV come in. So sometimes that muddies the picture a little bit. I think it's too early to predict what's going to happen. I'm a great woman for planning. And plans can change. So it's always better to have a plan in place and you potentially can use it, but you can also cancel what you can do. So I think put a plan in place, but be ready to change that plan if required.
September, October, you mentioned before being influenza and kind of flu season down to that kind of stage. Is there an increased risk at that time of the year? I know some players have discussed this, lower immune system or obviously playing and training that time of the year. Is there a higher risk to contracting COVID-19 during that time because of these reasons?
Not particularly. I think there'll be a risk like anybody else. What I would suggest, I'm a big advocate of influenza vaccine, and I think particularly this coming season, it would be very advisable for people. That obviously includes healthy young players to get vaccinated.
And look, yesterday at, I think it was at an Oireachtas committee, another expert in infectious diseases, Paddy Mallon, spoke about the fact that he believed it was inevitable that we were going to get a second wave. Your thoughts on that? Do you feel it is inevitable? And if it is, will it mean the country having to lock down as it has done during this first wave?
So, yeah, is it inevitable? And you know, that gives absolute certainty. I would say we probably will expect a second wave. The big difference between the first wave and a potential second wave is, first of all, we're much more prepared. Secondly, we know much more about the virus and where it happens in the country, because we know where the outbreaks have been, particularly in older residential care facilities and meat processing plants. So we have the ability to upscale all our contact tracing and testing as required. So, and therefore protect our hospital system. In my view, and I suppose this is only a view because of the uncertainty, that I doubt if we'll go into the major lockdown that we had already. I think if there is an outbreak, there may be, you know, a more focused restrictions, mm-hmm. as happened in Germany recently. Sure. So I think that's most likely what will happen.
And look, Mary, a final question for myself, and I'll leave Colm have the last word in it then. But, and I know this might be a difficult thing to do, but again, going back to the fact that we'll have players, coaches, supporters, parents listening. And we talk about the risk and minimising the risk, but can you quantify what the risk is, or is that too difficult a thing to do in terms of, if you could say on a scale of 1 to 10, what is the risk now with returning to sport?
Well, put it this way. I mean, if my kids don't play a huge amount of sport, but would I have any problem with sending them back to sport? Absolutely not. The risk, I mean, if you want to, there is no such thing as zero risk, but there is low risk, and the low risk is in younger people who have no other major underlying health conditions. And that's what we know as of now.
And Colm, as a club player with Stradbally, inter-county player with Laois, your last thoughts on it?
No, I think the last point there, the reason for this kind of podcast is just trying to inform players about the information they need to make a decision. It'll come down to the person, the individual themselves in the end. So for me, it's been very informative. I can identify what I need to do myself and what my teammates need to do themselves as well to help reduce the risk. I think if everyone can focus on that, it's hugely, hugely important that we're kind of engaging socially again, and the well-being part of playing sports is hugely beneficial too. So hopefully this will inform people and help them make the most, I suppose, guided decision they can. And Mary, thanks so much for coming on. Really appreciate it. Some fantastic information there. Thanks very much for what you've done also in getting us to hear yourself and the COVID-19 Advisory Committee.
And I think just to say that this will be an ongoing monitoring situation, and I think that should lead to, you know, reassurance with the players and spectators. We aren't going to just say, oh, we've done the job, off we go. This is a fluid situation and things may change one way or the other, as we've seen already, and Kieran mentioned that at the start of the podcast.
The Gaelic Players Association, representing the interests of all inter-county players, protecting their welfare on and off the pitch and supporting their development as people.
So, Colm, they're the views of Professor Mary Horgan. She's an infectious diseases expert. She's on the GEA's COVID Advisory Committee. She's the president of the Royal College of Physicians, a consultant physician in infectious diseases and internal medicine at Cork University Hospital. As a club player, as a guy who has involved in coaching, has been involved in cool camps, as an inter-county player, your thoughts and how you're feeling having heard what she's had to say?
You know, so straight away, Kieran, I think from my point of view as a player, I feel much more informed and much more confident in the decision I'm going to make as regards returning to play. I think, first of all, thanks to Mary again for the information she gave us, very clear and concise. But she highlighted one thing. I think we recognise this both as a society and as obviously people involved in the GAA, the importance of getting back into some form of normality in life for players, for supporters, for kids, keeping active. So if we can look at doing that and stick to those guidelines and understand the risks that's involved, I think we have a very good chance of getting through this with a positive outcome. I will say that one of the reasons we want to do the podcast would be to inform anyone who has concerns or risks. People will have varying concerns here, Kieran, and I've seen this down in training already. You know, there's some guys who probably aren't as concerned about it, you know, feel invincible in some way, they're fit, they're healthy. Other people may have maybe people of risk close to them that the other players don't know about. So what I'd say is that inform your teammates, talk to them about it, stick to the guidelines and responsibilities you have to do, because it's hugely important that everyone buys into that. And again, if you are concerned, hopefully this will enlighten you a bit, and you can make the decision yourself to either stay and play this year or opt out. And that is a viable option too, because, you know, sports isn't everything. Our health and our safety is the most important thing for us and our close ones. So overall, and it's great to have her on and to hear her say those things, and I feel much more confident now about trying to play and hopefully everything else.
Yeah, and I think, look, a huge thanks again to Professor Mary Horgan. That's it for the Player's Voice for this week. Hope you enjoyed that, and it's available across all our social media channels and also across all the usual places that you can get your podcasts. Until the next time, thanks for listening.